Hello everyone, today I'm in Zimbabwe. My name is Elece. I am the author and also the owner of the Vision production. And my channel, on this channel, I talk about cultures, traditions, lifestyle. And today I came back to Zimbabwe. I've been here for about 2 weeks. And we are going to talk about the different things, and I brought my friend Drelin. I think I have another video that you can actually link, that the link is below, that you can watch, that I started to say we are going to have a series of different videos that we are going to take about our trip, because this is the first time my friend had come to Africa as a whole, and then we are in Zimbabwe. We actually first to say Africa was in Kenya, and we kind of captured that situation. And you're going to also watch that video that we talk about how did she feel for the first time being in Africa, and we cover that part. And then today we are going to talk after 2 weeks of being in Zimbabwe. So we are going to talk trekking from that time until now, and just talk general, what was the feel and everything, because people have different feels about places and why they are in the place sometimes, you know, because before you think about I'm going somewhere, I believe it's the same thing, Jurelin.
Experiences. Yeah.
And, you know, why you want to be there, what exactly are you trying to get, you know, all those things. And I'll talk about also my feelings about her coming here, because it was all kinds of feel, you know, that you get about someone coming, and they're coming with you too, because you are thinking about the safety, this, you know, are they going to cope up with this? You know, all things. I was born here, I grew up here, so I know the lifestyle. As you can see here now, we are in my sister's garden, and I am going also to make another video showing you what my sister has in her garden. That a lot of people, they have a garden and they actually have similar stuff, which is like, you know, trees, fruit trees, vegetables, all kinds of things that they have. I'm going to make another video about that. But today we are going to talk about just our trip, the last 2 weeks, how it has been and how things have been unfolding. So Jurelin, maybe first introduce yourself again to our viewers and tell us about yourself and what you do, whatever, and then how did you again come to think you want to take this trip that I think many people, they want to, they hesitate. A number of things happen in between. They think it's so expensive, this and that, all kinds of things, you know. So tell us.
Well, my name is Drelin, Drelin Jones. I'm the author, not the author, I'm with an author. I am the founder of United Health and Wellness. That's a not-for-profit organization. And I wanted to build my organization, but I know that I have a desire for that foundation to serve in uniting people with mind, body, and spirit. Beyond that, I did not have a clear vision of what my trip to Zimbabwe would be or what it should be, but I knew I had to come. And as I mentioned in the first video that Elece talks about, when the pilot said, when we came into Kenya, he said, "Welcome home." And it spoke to my spirit in unexpected ways. I had no idea that I would have that feeling of, I'm home. But I still didn't know at that time what that meant. But I still feel it. Culture shock. What does home really mean? There's such a vast difference between the cultures and the lifestyle of Africa. When we came here, well, in Kenya, I didn't really get to see much more than the airport, but when we reached Harare, there are so many things that are happening in that culture that are political, economical, spiritual, physical, so much going on. But the consistency that I saw was the heart of the people. Mm. And I think that's the spirit of the human nature and what humanity is all about. And in the future, I'm sure Elece will probably write books and do videos on each aspect of that. Mm-hmm. But just to give you an idea, in Harare and throughout Zimbabwe, right now they're experiencing hard times, more than normal, because no electricity, number one, because the rains have not come, the waters are low. Now, I understand what that means a little bit from America, because we have a major flowing river. The Mississippi River goes through all of the states, or the main states in the United States, America, and we get our supplies from the ships that go from one end of that to the other. And that happened right after COVID, so there's a big devastation with supplies and with people who are working. That's nothing compared to what they're dealing with here. I can't even begin to share with what that means. So there's no electricity, there's no refrigeration, you can't buy and store things. What you have that needs to be stored, it has to be consumed within a short period of time, or it's just wasted. But in many ways, that doesn't stop the spirit of the Zimbabwean people. They still laugh. A lot.
We do.
And when something happens, or they have conversations, they dance. The children this morning, I got up, and they get up and they stretch and they dance. So this is a culture that is raised with happiness, and it's beyond the suffering.
Yeah.
To me, that's the spirit. Yeah. Spirit is supposed to be free, no matter what's happening out here. So that is a major observation that I've had for my soul and for my spirit, for my friend. You know, I'm hoping that at times when I ask her questions like, how are we going to get there? And she says, we'll figure it out. My American mind and worry mind, I have to let that go, because the same, as I tell her, the same God that protects me and my children and her children takes care of the multitudes of people that are here. I feel my job is, what can I do to make it easier? Because I don't believe people are supposed to suffer. Mm-hmm. That's my basic belief.
You know, I think Jirelen is talking from the perspective as a person who is studying the brain and actually teaching people to understand the brain. And I think these are some of the things that she really is observing. Like, no matter what your environment looks like, it seems like the mind, when you train it that I can still laugh, you can laugh. So what we are seeing, like what she's experiencing mainly, for me, it's kind of like, well, I'm going to that place again, because I know it, you know. But at the same time, I'm seeing like I'm more confused than she is, because for me, it's like the 30 years I haven't been living the life, it's like I'm confused, you know. I know now the things in the bathroom, they should be over here, and things in the kitchen should be here, and I come from the bedroom, I go in the kitchen, everything is in there, and then I go in the bathroom, everything is in there. But I come here, I take the toothpaste, I had to walk over there and get water over there, and then I would walk over there and brush my teeth over there, and then come, I have to put the toothpaste over here, and it's like I'm like, I don't know what's going on here. But Jirelen is taking it so well, and I think it's that understanding of training the brain and just be where it's supposed to be, and you are okay there. And I want to really add on to what she mentioned about the people. I mean, people, we laugh here. We really do. We laugh a
sometimes
lot.
Sometimes all night long.
Yes, we do. We laugh. You know, me and my sisters, we have so much to catch up with. And I end up here to tell Jirelen, like, she's confused, like, what are you talking about? Why are you laughing so much? Why are you, you know, what's going on? She doesn't ask me those questions, but I can tell she's doing that. So I said, you know what? There's petty talk, there's serious talk, there's nothing talk. And we laugh about all of it, you know. There's nothing talk. We laugh a lot about that. It's nothing. It's just...
It really is nothing. Just... When I had her translate, it's really nothing.
It's nothing talk.
But
know?
It's talk. It's sharing.
It's that it's, conversation, yeah, you know, yeah. That I think in the United States, you know, remember, my channel is about culture shock and cultures, the traditions and lifestyle. So in America, there's a difference, a huge difference about that. You know, if you have nothing to talk, please don't talk. No one is interested in that nothing talk of yours, you know. But here, it's incorporated into the lifestyle. It's what it is. We put that as something because it's part of the life. You know, we just put it together. You know, so if someone is coming to the from the river, they found people, they were talking about something, they bring it home, and then we talk about it too. And
and if I can add, just from the standpoint of how the brain works in neurology, in our brains, there's electrical impulses. Those electrical impulses are created to make communication. So it's like sharing of the spirit when people talk. And there's this little boy around here who doesn't even really speak English, but he wants to talk to me, which is a whole nother thing. I'm a little bit of a celebrity because they think I'm white. I am not white. For those of you who think I'm white, I'm not white. Americans will know that.
Yeah.
But here, they don't understand.
You know, they you don't. Know? And, you know, I did warn my friend Jurelen when we're coming here. That's one thing maybe I remember to kind of tell her that, you know, Jurelen, when we arrive in Zimbabwe, please, you know, don't worry, don't be bothered with it. They are going to think you are white. I understand, and don't feel offended by it.
Yeah,
because, you know, they are going to think you are white. And then when they think you are white, people, they're going to gravitate to you. It's not always, sometimes people, they think it's always about, you know, they want something from you. There is of that too, that expectation. But it's not the biggest thing, actually. The biggest thing is that we don't have people. We don't, first of all, they think you are white, right? We don't live with white people, okay? Yeah. We live just Africans here. So when we see a person like different from us, we are interested. We want to know about them. We want to share something. And, you know, those who don't know me, I'm also an author. So I just published my memoir. And I talk about a piece of a story there that talks about, you know, the first time I saw a white person, and it was at Bechnaf Bridge, one of our biggest bridges here. And we all ran to him, and we surrounded him. And I think he just thought, I don't know what's going on here. And we tried to use as little English as we had to try and talk to him. It wasn't anything to do. At that time, I don't even think I was thinking of anything about money. I remember just thinking, there is a white person in our village. Let's go and see him. That was it. So I did warn her about that. And, you know, she began to see it in real life. And I think she has something about that to tell us. Tell us, Jurelen, what is that you... you are experiencing in that area.
And that there's twofold, because what I recognize is that there's the curiosity of a child, and children are so pure, they're so innocent, they just they're curious and they want to know. There's also a gender curiosity. There's a curiosity of the women, and then there's the curiosity of the dominant male. And then there's, we'll make it a fourth curiosity, of the relationship of what white people have in relationship to the country. And so I want, I guess my own perception, because of my experiences, I want to make people feel comfortable. But I can't do that. Comfort comes from the individual. If there's insecurities there, those insecurities are going to be there. So when they interact with me, it's like, are you a threat? Or are you just something that I need to be curious about? So because of that, there was a little bit of caution within me. So I worked to make sure I remove that caution, because I want to be open, but I also want to be safe. So there's an experience that will come up that we'll probably do a different video about in relationship to that. But women are so giving. Women are so open. They're so compassionate. You know, men are like big boys. Little boys, but just big. And still dominant, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. So there's that experience. Overall, it's good. Because yeah. I think that we need to, in this world, we need to be able to embrace and know how can we interact and benefit from the differences.
The differences.
The differences, yeah. yeah.
And that's really important because sometimes the difference, again, can be taken, difference meaning someone is this and I am this. But difference just means that we live differently, we do differently, we eat differently, we maybe dress differently. We different means beauty to me. And I'm so passionate about cultures. I really am, you know, because when I look at cultures, there's no good or bad about a culture. It's what it is. That's all I call it. I just feel like a culture is what it is. So Zimbabwean people, they have their culture, and I feel, you know, this is who we are. This is what we are. Americans, they have their culture and traditions, whatever. Most of the time I'm being told there's no tradition in America. But I think what we call not tradition, that's the tradition. For example, you know, I have many videos talking about the things that shocked me in America. That's the tradition. No matter how it shocked me, but that's the tradition they do. That's the way they do things, because tradition is way of life. And once we understand that, that way of life, that's what it is. That's tradition. So however different it is. So let's now really just like go from the airport of Harare, because we had some pickup there. And you know, Africans, we don't have time. We have time, but we don't. You know, we have time, you know, but
in America,
things are done. That's
it,
what it is.
We call it CP time in America, colored people's time. It doesn't match your watch.
And here it's called the African time.
Yeah.
Really, we don't have time. And when they tell you it's going to be very soon, what does it mean, Jurele?
It means at least an hour.
And when they say, you know, it's just down here, what does that mean?
It might be a mile or two. I learned.
So to, I mean, you know, it's what it is. And, you know, everybody understands the language. That's the beauty of that. Everybody understands that language. So nobody's up and here, oh, you know, like this, you know. Sometimes I look at my friend, I don't say anything, you know, because she's a strong person. I look at her, she's like, so what time, Elsie? So, you know, I said, okay, I had to ask
Hopefully
my
I'm
sister.
Not that anxious.
I said, okay, I had to ask my sister. And she says, oh, okay. But she's so patient. I mean, I think, Jurelen, you're doing great. Tell us about the airport and tell us about the place, the first place. We had an Airbnb, and I think I have some videos that I might be showing about the Airbnb. But we had the Airbnb first, but tell us as we landed from Kenya to land at the airport to the Airbnb and our stay there to come to Mutari and all of that.
I think that's a long story.
Yeah.
I just, the first situation when we got to the airport was that there's a friend, cousin?
Yeah, cousin.
Cousin who's picking us up.
Mm-hmm.
But my thought was, usually you coordinate a time. You know, when you know your plane's going to land, you say, plane's going to land. Within an hour or so, we should have our luggage, and then you should be able to meet this person. Now, I don't speak the language.
Yeah.
So I'm hearing communication in Shauna, which I'm thinking is clear communication. Well, I guess it is clear communication. But the driver, from my understanding, was not sure what time the plane was going to land because there were some changes. And if I'm correct, Elsie wasn't sure what kind of the vehicle that he was driving.
That's correct.
And I'm thinking, well, they know each other. They recognize each other. But does he know to come up to this part? Because I don't see cars coming up here.
Yeah.
Is he in another place?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to sound anxious, but do we need to be down there so he can see us? or is he going to come up here? And the response I'm getting is, well, it's going to be okay. We'll figure it out. And I'm thinking, if you're not proactive in it being okay, how's it going to be okay?
Well, it seemed like I had transformed it to be Zimbabwean then. Yeah. You know, and you know, honestly, I remember that time. It was like, you know, but at the same time, you know, I understand, right? So it's like I imagine very quickly, you know, I imagine very quickly. But I think at some point I was forgetting that I am with a friend who can't just imagine. It's not imagining, it's learning. And I think the communication was a little bit less than what I should have done, in terms of like communicating everything. You know, I just imagine, I understand, you know, he might have been working and, you know, he's late. You know, things like that. But anyway, it ended up, you know, it was, you know, just what it is. We were not picked up by,
honestly,
that person.
Yeah. And honestly, I wasn't disturbed. I really had the confidence that we'd get where we're going to go, however we're going to get there.
Yeah.
And I tell the story after it's over, which is what I'm doing. But, you know,
that's the best time to do that. Yeah.
But I did find out, and Elece felt bad. I felt bad. The guy was there.
Yeah.
And we just never could connect with him.
We did not connect.
He was there from what time? 2 o'clock until 6 o'clock.
About three o'clock.
3 o'clock until six. All those hours.
Yeah.
But we never connected.
We could not connect. And he was relaxed too, sitting in the car, thinking that, you know, when, I don't know, I can't tell that story so well. But anyway, you know, we finally got into another taxi, got to our Airbnb, and that was my first shock, because the Airbnb I thought was, wasn't exactly I thought, you know. So things were slightly different than what I thought. And she took it well. She did not comment. She did not say anything. But I kind of felt like it was kind of, everything was good there, but there were things, like basic things that people should have, you know, like, I'm talking about people, meaning in America, you know, but here it's not basic. It's actually way up there. But, you know, coffee maker, microwave, any oven, I would say basic kitchen stuff that I felt should have been there.
Yeah.
They were not there. And I thought, okay, we arrive now. We might just need, it was evening then. I thought we might need just to get a cup of coffee or something like that. And we had to start going to the, anyway, I was a little bit disturbed about that, but the Airbnb, the place, the area, the area was very good, one of the best areas in Harare, you know. So, and then when we met the host, it was another game changer. So the Airbnb brought a different feel, but then we met the host. She was sweet. She looked like she was 19. She's 28, you know, and she was just
good energy.
Yeah.
Good,
beautiful,
spirit, willing, you know, to do anything she could to help us.
Anything you can to do. And
our phones, when we first got there, we thought we were all set, had international packages. We could call anybody and talk to anybody.
Yeah.
Not true.
No, that's not
Neither
true.
Neither of our phones worked.
Worked. And that was one of the problems we had at the airport.
Yeah.
Because we could not call the person that I thought I could use WhatsApp and call. By the way, those who want to travel to Zimbabwe, if you never use WhatsApp, I would say Africa, per se. If you never use WhatsApp, you need to download
it
now.
You have to have it. Yeah.
Because that's the best way for you to communicate with your loved ones. And you have to tell them, too, to download WhatsApp. They have to have WhatsApp.
I've
to
heard
communicate
that's good
better
worldwide.
Yeah.
My daughter is very...
Except in America, almost.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
In America, we know we have our packages already, including long distance and all these things, except maybe certain countries. So when you want to call those countries, you have to use WhatsApp. So WhatsApp is like the main, you know, the biggest, telephone services.
Yeah,
you can have.
Yeah,
so
you can video, you
know,
you can chat.
So all that did not work out. She bought the package, and I thought the company told me that you can use WhatsApp, and you pay so much per minute if you use the regular phone. Nothing worked.
the thing that I found out with mine, they absolutely guaranteed me that Zimbabwe is part of Africa, was going to work. They didn't know. I found out that I'm a trailblazer for this country mm-hmm. with their communication system. They're working on it now. I finally got where I can call out, not all the time, but sometimes.
Sometimes.
And the tech people, from what I understand, are still working on it. They say it has something to do with the infrastructure here in Zimbabwe, unique to Zimbabwe. Just a short statement. The UN, United Nations, has sanctioned this country because of their political philosophies and developments, and so that's outside of my realm of knowledge and information, but it has affected the way that this country is able to function. Mm-hmm. So that's a part of what's happening with our phone system, I believe. I could be wrong, but I think that everything in relationship to Zimbabwe is connected to a part of the what supports here and what doesn't support here. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But another side segment, I really feel that this country is unique in its ability to be a unifying factor for the world. I don't know why I feel that, but I really do. So I'm drawn to this country to do what I can to support. And there's just so many things, and yeah. I'll sort it all out when we get back. But.
Yeah. So I think you moving from there, you know, not to make the video too long, because we are going to have series, we are going yeah. to talk about different things. I think we are going to just, let's talk about, Jurelen, what the little things that you have done, for example, and that's my sister there. That's my sister, that's the host.
Let me let her
and
sit.
We are saying, no, it's okay, because, you know.
She never sits anyway.
she is the host, and I'm going to move the camera a little bit because I just want to show you, like, the garden we are in. It's not the garden that, like, the way we know in the West End, please. It's not.
You got to show them this land while she's in
there. Yeah. Okay. You know, this is the garden, meaning it's a garden of vegetables, fruits, vegetables. So. How's this camera doing now? Okay.
It's doing okay.
Okay. Yeah. So this is the garden she actually planted. Let's do it this way. Okay. This is her garden here. And it has fruit trees, different things that she planted in here. And she worked hard. Here, where we were looking here, we have a borehole. That by where she's standing there, behind her, there is a borehole. They get water from the borehole, and then they put in those buckets. I think you can see the buckets there, different containers they collect and put water. And then she watered this whole place with that water there. And they carry the buckets, and they go and pour in the beds, and carry the buckets and go and pour in the bed. I am going to show you another video showing the garden itself. So this one, we are talking about different things, but we are in the garden because it's beautiful. It's shady and the trees, and it's just beautiful. It's a different garden, like I said, because the garden we have, usually it's lawn and, you know, all the different manicured things that we have in our gardens, you know, those who have big gardens and stuff like that. But here it's garden of real garden with tomatoes, vegetables, fruit trees, all kinds of things. So she has a lot here. I think the last time I counted maybe was over 20 fruit trees here. And I'm going to go over it again. And about maybe, I don't know how many different types of vegetables. But I'll go over that again. So, Jurelen, let's continue.
You want to end that segment and then start it again with your sister?
Yeah, we can finish. So we are thinking now to just maybe end this video. And as we say, we just cover maybe a week, actually. Because our trip here, we haven't covered that. So we will talk about that another video, because this video will be too long. So, Jurelen, do you have any closing remarks? Just like, what do you think? We still have 2 weeks here. So,
oh, yeah.
You know, what do you think? What do you think that, you know, you're expecting something, or what? How do you feel now, from the beginning to now?
Actually, I feel really good. I didn't have an expectation of comfort. That wasn't my thought. If I had, it might have been more of a challenge. I remember we talked about an Airbnb, and I said, as long as they have a bathtub, I just want a bathtub so I can sit and soak. And I had all my bath stuff, supplies and things in my suitcase. And Elece sent me the pictures to the Airbnb. And I looked and I thought, I don't think she knows there's no bathtub.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, so she didn't know
until
we got here.
No, I really didn't, because observing those things is another section for me.
So I took all my bathtub stuff out.
Oh, you did?
I didn't pack it because I knew we didn't have one. And I thought, okay, I'm ready for this journey. No. And to me, that was an indication that I that's not what I came for.
Okay.
I didn't come for those comforts. I can get a bathtub any place, you know, any
that's
hotel.
True, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I felt like that my understanding needed to be, what is it that I need to see when I get here? And how am I supposed to be?
Yeah.
And so that gave me a clarity that I think prepared me for all the challenges that we had.
Wow. That's amazing, because, you know, when she looked at it, the answer she said, I said, did you see the Airbnb I sent you? She said, yes, I saw it. I didn't hear, you know, usually you expect a comment or question, or she didn't ask anything. So I thought, I kind of felt something was missing, but I couldn't figure that out. I couldn't tell what that was.
I didn't want you to be burdened with trying to make me comfortable. I can be comfortable anywhere, doing anything. I just wanted the experience of Africa.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm getting.
Yeah.
And I wanted to experience, and you have enough to deal with without trying to drag your friend along and make sure that they're okay. Your friend is fine.
Anyway, to me, that was really an experience, because honestly speaking, it was a little scary. Was a little, not scary that I can't take her. First of all, it's my first time to take someone from another country and bring them to my country. And second, there's really a huge difference, especially in the economical situation and, you know, lifestyle. And yeah, mm-hmm. You know, and the lifestyle and, the, you know, how a person is just used to the certain thing. And the other thing, I'm not going to lie, I was concerned mainly about the bathrooms. I was thinking, oh my God, you know, how is she going to deal with those outside toilets?
And
then she have squat, and, you know, I didn't know how to do that. And I was thinking, you know, how am I going to? So I kind of like snippets of telling her, okay, you know, we are going to face this, and we are going to face that. We are going, and at the same time, I don't want to scare her, because it will be like, I don't want you to come. I wanted her to feel like she wants to come, but at the same time, I don't want her to say, what? What is that? You know, so I brought my children before, and it was disaster, I tell you that. It was disaster. They hold it okay, but it wasn't easy. So I was thinking, I hope it's not going to be that way. So I think, you know, I was concerned, but, you know, I just say, you know what, she wants to come, she knows it's Africa, she knows things are not going to be the same, and I think I just have to be okay with it, and, you know, do what I need to do, and take her where I am, the tracks of, you know, where we are going to be. And we talk about, you know, what she wanted to do, maybe outside my path. And somehow it happened so quickly. Tell us about the lion.
That's a whole other story. I don't want to keep you, sister, waiting. But there, you know, are many things that we need to talk about.
Yeah,
many things.
So yeah. Anyway, you know, I think with this segment, you know, I am going to close here. And I'm going to thank you for those who have been following me, for those who are coming in. For those who are looking forward to hear more, we have a lot more coming up. So just subscribe, ring the notification bell so that we can notify you when another video is being put. Because while I'm in Zimbabwe, we are going to bring a lot of videos. So just be on the lookout and subscribe, please. So take care. Thank you so much for watching. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.